right, hello everybody. What is going on? We got Great Vanzini, Lord JP in the house. Let me resize a few windows here so I could see everybody's comments. There we go. Ron Dunnigan, Michael B., Buzz Wilson, Dave Byron. What is going on? Dwayne. Let me tune up real quick. I think I lost a little bit of tune in that last bend. DC Daryl Allen, what is up, everyone? Let me throw this back off of here. So this one here is the, that is the TTK2, very limited run we did with Diamond, and it's a special occasion guitar because Jeff's going to be coming on in 30 minutes, half past the hour. That was a little Billy Idol. I guess I didn't play it so bad because everybody noticed. May the 4th be with you all. What's going on, Terry? Mad Raj in the house, who owns one of these bad boys right here. The lighting in here isn't, there you go. Now you could really see the wood on here. Rob S, thank you, Robert, says it sounds great. So, yeah, we did talk about brisket last year, didn't we? So, Jeff's coming on today. We're going to have a little reveal because he has a big sale going on, up to 50% off on some things. And I also added some stuff on the Patreon site. I'm a Guitar Center affiliate. I don't do a whole lot of affiliate stuff with Guitar Center. So, there is kind of, I guess, an embargo on it. So, I put it behind on the Patreon site. So, it's not public. So, I didn't break any rules. It's actually, this is a trans red, if you could make that out. Flame maple, trans red. Back black, look at the neck. The neck has the burst. Hello to all. Tiago Cena, is it better to have an expensive amp and a cheap guitar or an expensive guitar and a cheap amp? I would say, if I had to choose, I'd go with the expensive guitar and the cheap amp. Only because I think the guitar will be worth more. It is. It's like a trans cherry. Can't really... It's got red binding, which is pretty awesome. Terry says cheap guitar, expensive amp. See, I always look at things in terms of, well, you know what? Time out. Let me take that back. Because there's a lot of really good affordable guitars that are really good. In fact, I have one here. Let me put this down for a second. Who wants to get right to an unboxing? Forget about that red binding, you love it. Let's do a quick unboxing, shall we? So I just got something in the mail, and we are going to unbox. I didn't want to do this off of camera. I wanted to do it on camera because it's fun. So this here is, it's a loaner. I didn't buy it. Oh, it actually comes shipped really nice. Anyone know what this is yet? This is called the foam guitar, the bubble wrap guitar. Listen to the tone, listen. It's very foamy. Anyone want to guess what this is? Anyone want to guess? See, I think those that pay close attention know what I like. And I was in, while I'm taking this out of its protective enclosure, look at this, like this anti-static metallic foam headstock thing. I saw this at Chuck Levin's, and I really wanted to review this. Because it was right up my alley. I think everyone would agree. Look at this. Looky, looky. So, who asked the question? what should you buy, a cheap guitar or an expensive guitar, cheap amp, or a cheap amp, expensive guitar? This right here is an awesome guitar. I love the reverse headstock. I love the white and the black. Active pickups, Floyd Rose trem. Let's get the battery in here. Isn't that cool? The reverse. I like reverse headstocks. I think I just like the aesthetic of it. You know? Hang on. Gotta get the Supercell in here. So it has the battery compartment in the back. It still has the little wire that sticks out. So I gotta connect it to the wire. There we go. Little out of tune. Nothing we can't fix. Let me throw this on. It's actually easy to throw on because got a big old headstock there. Here we go. Tuning a Floyd live. That's always fun. Cowtown Customs from Ohio. This is, by the way, this is like a smoked chrome Floyd, which I like a lot. See the smoked chrome Floyd? It's even tuned like, that's a good one, Terry. It's even tuned like a Hendrix guitar. All right, let's see if I could tune it without, I think, it's a D. I think I may need to pop the these open. Let's do that real quick. Gotta tune the Floyd. What model? What do the batteries do? So this has active pickups. I don't think it's an ebony. No, it's definitely not an ebony fretboard. It's got clay inlays, which I like a lot. By the way, there's a trick to tuning a Floyd. And I'll show everybody what that trick is. The tuning the Floyd, let's do this live, right? You always want to make sure those things are kind of right in the center. Let's see if we could get that. Not too up, not too down. That's what I mean right in the center. The little spinny things, right? And then I always start with my low E. Okay. Then my high E. Because you want to balance the strings. You know, the tension on the spring in the back. So low E first. High E. Then the B. Low E. High E, B. Then the A. Do it again. Low E. High E. B, A. That's how I always tune a Floyd. I'm telling you the exact order and it comes out perfect every time. And you keep going back. Low E, high E, B, A. And then I do the G. Low E, high E, B, A. G. Oh, it went to sleep. There we go. And last but not least, the D. We're in tune. So everybody always wanted to see, you know, how do you tune a Floyd? And we just did it in a few minutes. And it was way out of tune. Let's tighten this up. Let's fine tune it. It was way out of tune and we just did it, and look at the bridge. Nice and flush against the body. Perfect. I know, Vic, you're right. I should stretch the strings and do that again. But so nobody has to watch the pain of having to redo everything I just did again after you stretch the strings, we'll be okay for now. I won't do any crazy bends. So there's my E. We fine tune it. Fine tune the high E. Fine tune the B. The A, man, it's on the money. G, D, oh, we're right there. We are good. Jason Wade, what is going on, man? All right, let's pop this bad boy in there. Let's make some music. Peter Cruz, what's up, man? We'll be right back. So, there it is. That's a brand new axe. This is a Squire out of the box. We just had to tune it up. Fairly straightforward. Can someone give me the street price on this guitar? I think it's like $400, right? Reverse headstock. Matching reverse headstock, I should say. Right? And active pickups, Floyd Rose. Jakey Lee style body. Nice weight. $399. There it is. I mean, it's crazy. Zach Tong, what's up, man? So they're not EMGs. They're Squire pickups that look like EMGs, but they're not. But I'll tell you what, they're pretty good. Not a lot of noise. Now, granted, I have a noise gate up there, but they're pretty. If these were noisy, they would go right through the noise gate. Todd Flowers, how are you, dude? What is up? Tiago Pausis, Gregory Murphy. Yeah, this is brand new. And again, I saw this at Chuck Levin's and I was like, oh yeah. It's it looks like rosewood. I think it's rosewood. Clay inlays. Look at the inlays. They're not like the cheap white dots, they're actually clay. I don't know if you'd need to mod it. It's got a good bridge. It's got good pickups. You know, it's got an awesome headstock, which I like a lot. Tuned right up. We'll be right back. There it is. It comes alive. I'm an awful guitarist? Oh my god. Thank you for watching my live show. Even acoustically. Let's go on something clean. Here we go, some clean. Driver Sean, what's up, dude? So now I'm suffering of not having stretched my strings, like someone in the comments mentioned. It's out of tune a little bit. Anytime you get a new guitar, you should always stretch the strings. But still pretty good. What other colors are there? I think it's white and black on black, I think. I'm using the Black Widow. That's the white preamp in the back, and some of the stuff up there. But it's very simple. I'm just using the MIDI Verb for delay, and the Digitech TSR-12 for reverb, and that's it. That's kind of what I'm playing through. There he is.
I think I did it right.
You're on, man. Let me put this down for a sec. I was just doing a quick unboxing, but I'll show you something. I opened with this. I don't know if you caught the beginning. I broke out the TTK2 for everybody to enjoy.
I still have the Windows, obviously.
This was just phenomenal. Everyone's like, what guitar is that?
I love them.
You know. So, Jeff, welcome. For those that don't know Jeff, why don't you introduce yourself?
I'm Jeff Diamond. I'm a professional shit talker.
There you go. Yeah, Peter Cruz has a TTK2. Mad Raj has a TTK2, who is in there. So Al Martin says, is that a signature guitar? It is. We did two versions of that. Sorry about that. That's the TTK2. The first one was a TTK1, which was a BC Rich that was from 2010, maybe. And let me actually, saying we're getting an echo on you, so let me change something here. Hang on. Jeff, can you hear me okay?
I can hear you fine.
Okay. And everyone, is there still an echo?
I'm videoing you too, and videoing me while we're live.
But Robert says we all know and love Jeff.
Is that Baker?
No, Robert Music. Robert Coelho Music.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, the echo's gone. That's good. That's good. By the way, everyone's always asking what I... Tonight I'm drinking Gold Peak. Gold Peak sweet tea.
I'm drinking tea tonight, too.
Nice.
But I make my own... I don't make the tea. I mean, I make the... turn it into iced tea, but I get tea from this company called Mighty Leaf. That's really good. And you just brew it and make iced tea out of it. I used to drink that same tea that you drink, but I had to stop because there was too much sugar in it and it's not fitting with my diet.
Gotcha. We actually have to finish that conversation. I didn't forget. But you look good, dude.
Thank you. I had to sport the Astros gear.
Is are the Astros doing something phenomenal recently? Or,
of course.
There you go.
They're killing it this year. Let's not forget they were World Series champs. Yeah, didn't I send you a ball?
You did. You did. Yeah. It's sitting on my piano.
Is it really?
You want me to show everyone?
Oh, you have it in there?
I do.
Yeah, the Astros World Series ball.
Hang on, I'll get it.
Yeah, look at that. That's an official World Series ball.
There you go. Can everyone see that? You know, I totally forgot about this. I wasn't putting two and two together. So I have a piano down here, dude. Did you know that?
No, I did not know that.
It took four guys to carry it down two flights of steps. That are real narrow.
Yeah.
So we're gonna have an unboxing party, but we already did that. We're gonna have a reveal party. So you have some sales going on. It is the 4th of July. So happy 4th of July, everybody. Happy birthday to America. And Jeff has some stuff going on.
I do. You know what I did too? Since we were coming on, I put it live early. It was supposed to go on in like a half hour.
But is it on right now?
Put it up now so I can, so that people who are watching can try to get to it before everybody else.
Okay, that sounds good. So let's refresh this page. So in the link of this description, there is a URL called diamondguitars.com/July4. And I am going to look at it right now. Actually, let me see if I could share my screen.
Oh, yeah, that'd be cool.
Share. Share. Present to everyone. All right.
Oh, yeah, look at that.
So what do we have going on here? I love the purple.
Yeah, so what I did was basically I took a lot of the new models and, you know, just for July 4th sale, we just did some killer pricing on them. Maybe can you scroll down maybe?
Yeah.
I have two of the Monarchs up top, then that brand new then there's a brand new Galaxy Purple Bolero LTX, which is the new Bolero in the color changing paint. We got marked down in the Renegade, which is great with the EMGs. And then there's some, like, if you go a little further, I think, yeah, so there's a new Barchetta. There's a favorite Hailfire that people had, that people have liked in the past. And then I think that those are, the next two are both new. that Gray Smoke Hellfire SM. That's a brand new guitar for us.
That's nice.
Yeah, it's really cool, I think. And then the house, the Ghost White Halcyon, that's a new one also. The Lime Green Imperial, that's a killer price on that. That's $849 marked down to $599 with the Bigsby and a semi-hollow with the Bigsby, with the thin, but with the thin line design of the Imperial, and then a brand new Maverick in a cool color configuration. And then if you scroll a little further down, there's some new featured guitars that we have in stock. All of those are brand new guitars that aren't really on sale, but are now here and people can get them. And then the bottom section was some of the new guitars that we've got back in stock that people have been waiting on. Mm-hmm. Semi-hollow Imperial, Ice Blue Bolero, the color-changing 7-string, which is a great one. And then I think I got 2 Renegades below that, and we got the Trans Ruby Maverick SM back in. If you'll scroll just to the top of that first row again.
I have that.
Yeah, that's the one you have, right?
Yep.
I didn't want people to miss this. No, go back down to that section we were just on.
Oh, sorry.
You're right there.
Yep.
Those 6 that were below that are back in stock, I didn't want people to miss. There is a coupon code there, you can see in the text
right above. Finally 15.
Yeah. So you can get, even though they're not technically on sale, you can get 15 off.
I'm glad you said that, because I didn't see this until you pointed it out.
Yeah, that's why I wanted to bring it up. And
maybe you need to put that in hemi green.
I thought about it actually, or putting it in some color, except for the fact that I don't necessarily want to sell them because they're super popular guitars. And if I sell them at discount, I just, you know, lose money on them. But I wanted people to have the opportunity because a lot of people have been waiting on restocking of those guitars.
Right, right.
So I figured, you know, during the limited sale, you know, give them some discount on it so they can pick some of those up. So, I mean, there's those 6, and then there's the 10 above it. So it's like 16 different guitars that are on sale. And the ones above it, some of those are over 50%, almost 60% off.
Yep. So I have some commentary here. Mm-hmm. So I was just at the PRS Experience event. And, you know, PRS makes guitars just for the event. Let me actually stop sharing real quick so I could see you and check on some comments and stuff. So... it's interesting because PRS just had, as I said, their experience. And you know what the theme for the experience was?
What?
Semi-hollow guitars.
Huh.
All their guitars that they made special for the show that the dealers buy, all semi-hollow. So what's nice about that is right at the top, that's one of the ones that you have a big discount on in the Trans Ruby. At $649 versus, you know... I mean, that guitar for a PRS, you're looking at, you know, a lot of money.
Yeah, that's right. And it's, you know, it's going to be, ours, of course, has the, you know, Grover tuners. It's got Seymour Duncan pickups in it. You know, I don't know what you're getting that's that much more for $3,000 from PRS, but... you know, that's a cool one. The trans purple one that's sitting next to it is really cool because it's got a bird's eye maple top on it.
Mm-hmm.
In a really cool color, also with Seymour Duncan's in it. So, you know, cool guitars, I think, both.
Let me see if I could share some pictures with you here. Okay, so let me share my screen again so I could show you some stuff. Okay, could you see my screen again?
Yeah.
So this is my Instagram account. And again, I wanted to share with you some of the similarity here. By the way, did you ever see my motorcycle?
I did.
There it is. So this is the Sky that I reminded me of, the Imperial that I have. The one that we got from Rift City, if you remember. Remember that one?
Yeah.
That's the color of that guitar. So here's the thing. If you look here, boom, semi-hollow, right? A ton of semi-hollow guitars at PRS. There's another semi-hollow right over here. Look at that, right here. There it is. right?
Yeah. So
check this out. This was a PRX.
Oh my God, they made the lime green.
Green. Look at this. Hold on. Let's go down here. Boom. There it is.
You have no idea. Like, look, I mean, all due respect to PRS. They're a good company. They've been around a long time. But you have no idea how many custom finishes I've done that they've then ripped off and pitched as their own.
There's another semi right over here. Oh, by the way, see this? This is a Framus guitar that I recently got. I don't know how well you could see this guitar.
Idolmaker, it's a Stevie Salas.
Yeah, but you see what they did with the top. If you come over here, check this out. Boom, there it is. And I guess the message I'm saying is, you know, everyone knows I'm a guitar collector, right? I got this. I don't have the lime green, but I love that. And if you dig what I dig, if you're into this sort of lime green or the Framus, I mean, these are, there it is. You got one right here. So here's the shopping list, right? One, two, three, right off the top.
So here's the story on that Stevie Salas Idolmaker too.
Yeah, what is this story? What a great guitar, by the way.
It is a great guitar, but you know when it came out?
When?
Right after Stevie started playing one of my Hailfires. Stevie got for me, there's pictures of it somewhere on maybe our Facebook page or something where Stevie was got from me.
Hang on one second. So Terry, thank you for putting the link in the description. If anybody wants to see the guitars I was just looking at, Terry just put the link in, diamondguitars.com/July4. It'll take you right to all the guitars we were just looking at. Or just click the link in the description. It's right in the description as well. And of course, if you want to see the guitars I was referencing on my Instagram, it's just instagram.com/thetoneking. And so, the July to you too, Al Martin. Go ahead, Jeff. I'm sorry.
Oh, no worries. So Stevie fell in love with the Hailfire, and he has what was one that we did several years ago that was a trans teal Hailfire SM.
Okay.
And there's some pictures of it on the Facebook page where he got it. And then a year later, Framus came out with the Idolmaker, which looks really close to the Hailfire. It's different, but it looks real close. He uses the scoops and that sort of thing that we do on that one.
So you think he kind of brought the idea to Framus?
I know he did. He told me he did. I mean, look, Stevie is a friend and I love him.
Yeah.
But it was unquestionably the impetus for the design of the Idolmaker, and so much so that he has another one of my guitars that has my custom signature series Seymour Duncan set.
Okay.
And he actually went to HP and was like, and told them, I want to put Jeff's signature series Seymour Duncan set in my Idolmaker guitars.
And so is that what's in the Idolmaker?
No, as I think HP said no. And then what we did is we tweaked it slightly and we designed a pickup for Stevie that was going to be a set co-designed by me and him that they were going to use, so that they didn't have, you know, the DBZ Diamond signature series set in there. It was extremely similar, obviously, but they were going to use that set, and I don't think they ever ended up doing it, but I know Seymour had the part number and was ready to make them. I just don't think they ever actually ended up putting them into the guitars. But I'm like, at some point I was like, look, Stevie, you know, you're using my amps on about half the stuff that you're doing. You now have my Hailfire turned into a Framus, and now you want to use my pickups on your Framus.
How does he respond to that?
He's like, well, I can't help it. I love them. I'm like, all right, whatever.
Well, you know, this is the industry where everybody copies everybody, down to the first Strat and Les Paul and Fender Bassman and all that, right?
Do you know that when I came out with the Monarch Ice Blue, the EX Ice Blue, I released it at NAMM, which was the first time anybody ever saw it, and PRS sent two people into my booth that were photographing guitars, and about 6 months later, they duplicated my finish and were showing it on their website as out of their USA custom shop. And I actually clipped the picture and I juxtaposed it next to mine that had been released like 9 months earlier at NAMM, and ran an ad on Facebook specifically to target PRS customers that said, like, here's the new PRS custom. Here's the one I released 9 months ago.
I think I remember that.
I was like, really, guys, you couldn't come up with your own finishes? And so they copied the lime green. They copied.
I love that lime green, man.
Yeah.
I don't know why. I think it's just because it pops.
Yeah. My buddy, Steve Chartier, I don't know if you remember a place called Bulldog Guitars, but that was Steve's. He just bought one. Steve's the green guitar nut. He finally just ordered his. And it's even more stunning in real life than when you're seeing it over the web, you know.
I believe it.
Just it's hard to capture the dimension of the finish on a two-dimensional photograph, but you know, they've come out with I think they've come out with four of my finishes. PRS has since. ESP came out with three of my finishes that were so poorly executed. I was
one of them was Snow Leopard, wasn't it? The Snow Leopard.
No, Snow Leopard was a similar version to what I did with the Siberian Quilt.
Yeah, I remember that. I love that guitar.
That was Schecter. And Schecter could never get it right because they couldn't figure out what I was doing to keep the color consistency. So they had real bad problems with theirs being off color, either blue or green or yellow.
I remember the green ones.
Yeah, yep. They never could figure out how I kept the color consistent. Mm-hmm. They had a process for keeping the color consistent.
This was also much darker. Yours was much lighter.
Yeah.
Yep.
ESP took they took my Siberian Quilt Finish 2 and tried to do it matte, and it came out terrible. They took my Tiger's Eye, which was not the factory's color. I had a special blend for Tiger's Eye. And then they took my Room of Tears finish, put it on like a M2 body, and it was so poorly executed. I was like, I would have been okay with it if y'all hadn't executed it so poorly. That was the insulting part, is that they took what I thought was a really cool finish and made it look tacky. Michael Kelly took my fades, like the Moonrise series, and duplicated them.
So you're swinging in every direction tonight.
Yeah, I know. It was kind of, you know, I don't really mind.
Let me rope it in a little bit.
I mean, I will tell you that there is a very, very prominent company, guitar company, who I was talking to, the second highest person at, and they were at least toying around with the idea of wanting to buy my company for a few minutes. They never really didn't go anywhere, but we're looking at my designs and said, you know, man, I wish we could do this. I mean, this is a major brand. Mm-hmm. And they're like, man, I wish we could do stuff like this. Like at our company, we seem to only want to release now three colors, black, satin, matte black, and trans black.
Who's that? Oh, wait, hold on. Let me guess. Who would that be?
You don't want to tell you, do you?
Yeah. Who is it?
I can't tell you because I'm going to tell you the following reason. For the following reason, they do produce guitars at the same factory as me. Mm-hmm. One of the ways I do my finishes, I have a special technique. Like in order to get the finishes that I wanted, you know, I had to spend time over in Korea and teach them how to do the finishes I wanted. I had to redesign their paint process to be able to do what I do, because when you do them in the U.S. and you hand rub stain, you can do things with them that you can't when you're shooting color on the guitars, which is how you do it for larger manufacturing. So I had to go over and redefine the paint process so they could do my colors. And they actually, this company, after looking at that, actually called the factory and said, we want to use his colors, and listed out several of my colors. And they finally had to tell him, like, dude, we can't do that. I mean, like, that's his paint process. Like, it's one thing to use a color we're making, but you're now asking us to give you his entire paint process.
Huh.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Mm-hmm.
So on that note, I have a question for you.
Yeah.
Can we change topics for a second? On the topic of guitars, but slightly change it a bit.
Talk about anything you want.
Okay. Summer NAMM just ended. Did you see anything? Were you in tune with what was there? And by the way, everyone tuning in, anything exciting at Summer NAMM? I have to be honest with you. Charvel came out with some cool stuff. You know what seems to be the hottest thing, Jeff, lately?
What?
Burnt maple necks.
Well, okay, so you want to know why?
Sharp fret ends?
No.
I don't know. That would have been my only guess.
No, it's because of the rosewood problem.
Interesting.
So the deal is rosewood's becoming seriously problematic because, you know, in there are some countries that you can't even ship it into. Like, I'm already starting to have to substitute out everything going into Europe that's rosewood. I'm having to substitute out ebony.
Mm-hmm. By the way, Habs was asking if that's the Diamond Guitars dude. That is the Diamond Guitars dude if you're just coming in. And there was a couple of other questions. Hang on one second, Jeff. Jason Wade says, Jeff, does the Halcyon STFR have a Floyd Rose Special or a Floyd Rose 1000?
The Halcyon STFR has a Floyd Rose Special.
Okay. I think there was one more question here. Nope, that was it. Okay, so go ahead. You were saying?
Well, so I'm already having to substitute out ebony for rosewood going into Europe going forward.
So you can't get rosewood in Europe?
Can't send it in anymore because all this CITES treaty stuff has been a huge problem. So I already had to start to make that conversion, and it's a limited period of time before they're going to ban rosewood use in the U.S. as well. That's one of the reasons why I've stuck with rosewood instead of ebony, because it's going to be something that you can't get anymore. And ebony is more expensive. So when you start going to ebony, you have to raise the price of the guitars because it's a fair bit more expensive. But incidentally, people think, well, it's because ebony is better. It's not. It's different. It's not better. It's brighter than rosewood. So I don't particularly like it as much as I do the rosewood. Some people like it for the feel more than the tone, because it's very smooth wood, but it doesn't have that natural wood feel. It feels plasticky. And
which one feels plasticky? The ebony?
Does. But
I didn't hear you. One more time?
Ebony does.
Gotcha. Okay. Okay.
But the thing is, the reason that ebony is more expensive is not because it's a higher grade wood. It's because it's extremely brittle, which means it's very, very difficult to work with. And it takes substantially longer to make ebony necks and inlay them than it does because it's very easy to break it.
Right.
So, but in any event, ebony's okay. It's not going to be on the CITES list. So you can switch to ebony. It's just going to drive the price up. So all the manufacturers have been looking for alternatives to rosewood because we're going to have to stop using it.
What happens with all the, you know, someone that has guitars that have rosewood, what happens to those? Do they become uncollectible?
No. I mean, it's nothing prevents you from selling it on the used market. Nothing keeps you from owning it. It's not like a, you know, illegally banned weapon or something that the government's going to try to seize. You can keep them all and use them for the rest of your life. You can sell them on the used market as well, but you can't import it. And that's the issue. And so you won't be able to get new guitars with rosewood on them. So everybody's been looking for alternatives. Maple's fine and ebony's fine, but ebony is a manufacturing nightmare, and maple changes the look of the guitar. Not more or less desirable, as you know, it's just a different look and a little bit different tone, but nothing satisfying that warm rosewood tone. So what a lot of people have been doing was going to burnt maple, which is just literally that. It's a process of burning it to try to darken it in color and make it look not just so blonde.
I think Gibson did that originally with the government series thing. You remember that? And Gibson, then
I think, was the first ones to use burnt maple.
Yeah, but there was a reason. Was it the government when they took their stuff, or there was something else?
No, it was that.
Oh, that was when they went to, because they took all the, yeah, okay.
When they raided, it was over the issue of their use of illegal Brazilian rosewood.
Right. So, and now you get companies like Ernie Ball that are doing completely roasted maple necks. You have Charvel, Ibanez has it. Charvel just came out with it. It's like everyone's jumping on the bandwagon.
Well, the other alternative that you're seeing a lot of, which is much to my chagrin, is phenelic. a lot of people
on plastic.
Yeah. That's basically what it is. And it's designed to emulate the look, but they're literally essentially putting plastic fingerboards on the guitars and big name brands.
Oh, that's the that's like Rich Light. That's Rich Light, right?
Yeah.
So I actually have a video. I met the guy at Rich Light, not this summer, Nam, last year. I didn't go this year. And he had mentioned I don't remember what he said, paper, cardboard, something with resin compressed, you know, as much as it could be. And it looks like, I guess it's like recycled material, just compressed with resin. Does that sound right?
Yes.
What do you think, that's a good idea or a bad idea?
What does it sound like to you?
I don't know. It
sounds like, to me, it sounds like making a guitar cabinet out of press board.
Hmm.
And interestingly, there's a whole lot of people who do it.
Who? What do you mean? You mean that they sell it as wood, but they don't disclose that it is?
Well, press board is wood. It's just chipped up wood that's been glued together and pressed together to make a flat board.
No, but I mean on guitars. Do you think there are companies that are like tricking consumers into saying that this is one thing when it's really something else?
Oh, probably. I mean, I know some major companies that have been disclosing that were saying guitars were maple over mahogany, and they're not. They're basswood.
Mm-hmm.
Which they use because it's really inexpensive and it does alter the tone. Cause you know, if you're expecting to hear, maple over mahogany, what you know is it brightens the mahogany. So what they're doing is they're then taking mahogany bodies and then putting, basswood tops on them and then flame veneers. So you get the look of flame, which is common, obviously, technique for imported guitars, but you're hearing the tone alteration, but it's not really the one you're expecting to hear because they're really giving you basswood to emulate it, but they're telling you that it's flame maple.
Mm-hmm.
It's problematic. I mean, it's, and I don't like the fact that people are doing, that's one of the things that we've always tried to do is like, you know, I just don't believe in doing that, but I'll tell you that it would not, surprised me at all. I haven't exactly done any surveys to see for the people who are using Fenelic what they're calling it. But I'm sure they're using it somehow.
So Tactical Six String is right. I do have a Rich Light board guitar. It's my a Gibson Zach Wild Modern of Doom. But you know, that's a guitar that has EMGs. You plug it into a high gain amp. I don't think it really matters what's on the guitar. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know, for me, if I was playing clean or like slightly overdriven in a, you know, very clean environment, I could tell the tone more precisely than just plug it into a high gain amp using the guitar like a screwdriver or a wrench. You know what I mean?
Right.
So
you'd be amazed at how much of that goes on in the guitar community where the companies are just being flat out dishonest about what they're doing.
Mm.
And when selling stuff to the consumers that way, it's far more prevalent than you could ever possibly imagine, but it's very disappointing to see it.
You know, so here's something interesting. This kind of goes into the whole tone wood thing, which is creeping its way into the chat. But you know, what's interesting, this was interesting to me. Tone wood is one of those things that people talk about. It's really hard for people to prove, right?
Mm-hmm.
I think what sold me on this, two things. The first thing was, actually, it was Paul Reed Smith. He did a TED Talks. Do you like TED Talks? I love TED Talks.
Yeah.
He actually did a TED Talks, and he was hitting a piece of wood. And he said, do you hear that? That was a tone. Like, there was actually literally, it was like a belt chime type of thing. Mm-hmm. He's like, that's a note. That's tone wood, right? If it resonates and makes a note, that's tone wood, right? Something else he actually did at the PRS experience, he took guitar necks and made what's the thing when you like a hammer with the metal bars, like a marimba or something like that? Xylophone. He made like a xylophone out of guitar necks, and every guitar neck, a wooden PRS guitar necks. Every guitar neck had a different tone, just wood. No smoke and mirrors. I'm like, that's tone wood, literally. So I think that's, you know, and then of course you get into, you know, it resonates and what resonates more, what's dull, what's not. So I believe there's truth to just having good wood or not good wood, right?
So there's a bunch of things like that in music. And like, for example, wood has different densities. When you move to different types of wood, they're going to have different densities, different compositions. So it's natural that they're going to resonate differently. And believe it or not, not only does that have an impact, of course, even pieces of wood within the same species can sound a little different, but the shape of the body can have an impact on the tone of the guitar.
Yep.
And I know that because I've built like a Bolero and a Hailfire out of the same batch of wood, and they'll come out sounding very differently, even when you mirror the pickups. But, you know, this is one of those things that we talked about that are, yes, it's difficult to explain. Like, if you remember back to the Guitar Gear Tech Talk days,
yep,
we talked about amplifiers. And one of the things we were talking about is mathematically, you cannot establish why changing the composition of resistors and capacitors impacts the tone of an amplifier. And mathematically, electronics people will tell you that's impossible. The math doesn't work. It has no impact. But yet you can physically change the components from one composition to another and hear the tonal difference in the amplifier. Yes, electronically, it works the same way, but it comes out sounding different. Well, nobody can explain why carbon comp resistors sound different than metal film resistors. There's no explanation for it. Mm. But it's, the proof is you can switch two out of the same value and hear the difference.
Yep.
So, hey,
John Parson is asking if the guitars include a gig bag.
They do not, no.
Do you have gig bags that he could buy?
Yeah, we should still have the Diamond Tactical ones on the website. You know, they're not on the website. They're on the Diamond Custom Shop website. So if you go to diamondcustomshop.com instead, you can find our Diamond Tactical ones. We have those. Those are cool. Of course, if you remember, were cool because they have a MOLLE system on the front, so you can add different pouches to customize the carrying configuration of the bag.
Yep.
We have those. And those will fit. Those fit every one of our models.
Yep.
But those are on diamondcustomshop.com, which is our companion store.
Thank you, Terry.
Did Terry put the link in it?
Ramon wants to know if you'll ship from Houston.
Yes, we will. We actually do. There's two options. You can have it shipped just like everybody else.
I know that's not really what he was asking, but it was funny reading the comment. Shipping from Houston? Question mark. Yeah, of course we ship from Houston.
Yes. He might have meant, do we ship to Houston from Houston?
I would have guessed he was probably asking, like, what does shipping cost from Houston? But he didn't write that. It was just shipping from Houston.
We charge, yes, all of it ships from Houston. And we charge the same price, by the way, for every guitar that's shipped. It's $37.50 for one guitar, no matter where it goes in the United States. If it goes in a case, it's bigger and more expensive, so then it goes to, like, $42. But it doesn't matter where you are in the continental U.S. It costs the same. And it's only like $45 to ship to Canada, too.
Jeff, let me ask you a question.
Mm-hmm.
You know I always want a good deal, right?
I had no idea.
So on behalf of the 180 people that are watching right now, can you give a coupon code? If somebody, remember, they'd have to be an hour in to hear that coupon code that'll save them just a little bit more if they buy a guitar. What can you give them a special coupon code?
Yeah, I'll set it up while we're talking right now.
All right, let's ask them, what do you want the coupon code to be?
Oh, so come on now.
So they could think this isn't rigged. What do you want the coupon code to be? Not the amount. That's up to Jeff. I'm just asking for a better deal. What do you want it to be? Like, what's the name of the coupon code?
Well, the name of the code.
The name. Yeah, if they'll be like, give us 90% off. No, they misunderstood. Not the amount, the name. What do you want the name to be?
So, like, what they type in to actually get the discount.
Yeah. Oh, Dave R. was the first one to reply, and he wrote TTK Live. I like it. Let's do that.
All right. In fact, you come up with a two-digit number right now, Lewis.
The actual discount?
No, just a random two-digit number. Make it an easy one for people to remember, like 99 or something.
How about 04, July 4th?
So the code is going to be TTKLive04.
There you go.
And what I'm going to do...
TTKLive04.
And what I'm going to do is I'm going to do $20 off the shipping.
Beautiful. You're welcome, everybody.
It's only going to run while the special's running, by the way.
Yep.
But it'll give you... That basically cuts the shipping to less than half price.
Okay. There you go. Thank you, Jeff.
You're welcome.
So you got the deals already there.
TTKLive04, one word.
Yep. Hab says, yay, we're getting some of these. There it is. Good. All right. So what, Jeff, what are you doing for the 4th of July?
So I'm going over to my mom's house where they'll cook. My mom and my stepdad will cook hamburgers, and she's kind of got this formula down where she does really fantastic ones now.
What does she put in it?
You know, I don't know what she puts. I mean, it's just good beef, and she puts some seasoning in it, but I don't know what seasoning she puts in it. But there's actually kale. She puts a little ground up kale in the burgers. First time she ever did it was the other day. And I was like, man, these are really good. What was different? And then my stepdad cooks them on the grill. Won't let my mom do it because she burns the buns. So it's otherwise just a straightforward burger, backyard style burger. So we're going to do that. And then I'm going to go downtown later in the day for Mexican food, followed by the fireworks.
Nice. Very cool. So a little trick that my wife sometimes does, the kids don't like it, but I love it, is like from onion, when you make onion soup, that powder.
Yeah.
You put onion soup powder in the burger mix, and it just with cheddar cheese melted on top, phenomenal burger.
Nice.
That's our trick. Other than that, just salt and pepper. Grilled, yep. Like you said, good beef. Salt and pepper grilled. It's good.
Yeah. The thing that's been killing me is in my office downtown for my other business, there's a right at the base where you go into the tunnel, and it's probably the best burgers in Houston. And that's been killing me lately. So I've had to radically adjust my diet for like when I know there's a week that I'm just going to have to get a burger, I now have to adjust my diet.
Yep.
And or get an extra workout in.
Yeah, you've been hitting the gym, huh?
Yeah, about four times a week, I guess.
I need to start hitting the gym. Just tell my wife tonight, it's about that time.
It doesn't get any easier for us to take off weight.
I know. So, yeah.
Plus, I'm planning on returning to my career as an underwear model, so I have to get back in shape for that.
Yeah. Yeah, me too, actually. That's funny. So ironic.
Yeah. Well, both of us, that was a big part of our past when we did the underwear models.
So Jamie Scott Thomas says, stop smoking. Are you smoking cigarettes or?
Yes.
Not cigarettes.
I'm not.
So you stopped the sugar, but not the cigarettes.
Hey, man, baby steps. Cigarettes don't have calories. Of course, they have lots of other bad things, but.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, that's funny.
Yeah.
All right. So about an hour in, and
one of the things I know from when we do these live broadcasts is that a lot of those guys end up asking questions.
Yeah.
But we need to make sure that we set aside a time and let people start firing their questions in before we wrap up ever.
Yeah, why don't we start doing that now? If you have any questions that you'd like for me or for Jeff, we'll go, you know, 15, 20 minutes on questions. We'll wrap this up at about in about 20 or 25 minutes. So fire away.
Some of those guitars, by the way, on the sale, a lot of the new models, like, I don't know if how many people have caught on to this, but one of the things that we've been doing is to keep things fresh. When I bring out new models, we'll run them once, maybe twice, sometimes only once, sometimes twice, and then I cycle them out and I bring in new stuff. Like, we've introduced 20 something new guitars already this year. And they kind of come in waves. I'll do like 8 or 9. I'll do another 8 or 9. I'll do another 8 or 9. And so a lot of those guitars on there, if you see them, they will not be around long. We don't build in high quantities and they don't stick around because I like to cycle them out and do fresh stuff. So if you see stuff on there that you like, chances are very high you won't see it again. So, you know, if you're wondering whether you should pull the trigger or wait for that guitar to go on sale again, chances are a lot higher it's not going to exist after I run them.
So here comes some questions. How long is the sale for?
Through July 8th.
All right. So you have a couple of days. Can Tiago Cena buy a guitar from Canada?
Yes. We ship to Canada for, I think it's like $45 or $49.
Okay. Will the coupon code work for the Canadian shipping?
Yep.
There you go. There it is. There it is, Tiago.
I did it as a straight $20 discount, so it'll apply to any shipping.
Perfect. All right. What do you think of the new player strat from Fender? I guess I'll take that one since I just covered it. I think it's a great deal. I just put two videos up. I compared the players to the standard, and I think the players won. The standard is now discontinued. And I compared the players to the American Professional, and I'll tell you, the players held its own. So I think Fender is upping their game in their non-U.S. made Fender guitars. Probably worth checking out.
Yeah.
Good job there. Actually, Jeff, it's an interesting topic. There are some people saying that, oh, look at that. Heb says it's a Canada Day coupon, not just a 4th of July coupon. So some people say that if Fender is an example up the game on their import series, does that affect their US series? What's your opinion on that?
Yeah, I mean, Fender is moving the way that a lot of other companies did, and same thing with PRS. You know, the bulk of their business comes from their imported guitars, not their USA guitars. And so the more they up the game on the independent, I mean, on the imported stuff, you can sort of assume you'll see an equal and opposite decline in the US production.
So what happens to US production? Is it just become custom shop collector grade stuff?
Yeah, largely. You know, I mean, if you look at PRS, PRS has sold more SE imported guitars.
Yes.
Released them since then the entire history of American guitars in the PRS company.
That was actually, I did a tall tour, which, by the way, if you've been watching my series, I have more to come. Stay tuned. I just have to edit more. By the way, Brian from Oregon, hello. What is going on? He's saying, where are the diamond guitars made? I know the answer, but why don't you answer?
South Korea.
There it is.
Actually, in the same factory that PRS used to make the SEs, the bulk of the SEs have moved to Indonesia now. Mm-hmm. But for many, many years, all of the SEs were only made in South Korea and at the same factory where I make all of mine. So that way we could guarantee the same or greater quality. But now they're moving into Indonesia and we've stayed in South Korea. But 100% of our guitars, if you're buying it off our website, it was made in South Korea.
Yep. So someone asked what my favorite diamond model is. I think a lot of people would think it's this, right? This was a custom run. This is the TTK2. I love this guitar. But I have to tell you, Jeff, I don't know if this is my absolute favorite. Like the Hailfire, the white and black one, that guitar rocks.
Yeah.
I love this. But I that's a really badass guitar also.
There's some kind of little magic in that body shape.
I would say this is my favorite from It's Mine, right? You know, it's we did this together. You know what? This is my favorite. This is my favorite Diamond guitar. But I think the Hailfire is probably my favorite series.
It's probably mine too. Now, I mean, I'm kind of a traditionalist, so I mean, I like the Halcyons like you're holding, and I like the Barchetta quite a bit. That's just sort of what I grew up with. But of everything else I make, probably my next favorite is going to be the Hailfire for sure.
Yeah.
There's a few. There's more than a few of them in my personal collection.
Maybe someday, Jeff, we do the TTK2, this in a Hailfire.
Yeah, that would be pretty badass, actually.
This guitar and a Hailfire. What do you think?
That would be very cool, actually.
All right, let me put that guitar down. I'm just making more work for you right now. Zach Tong, you also have a good night. Happy 4th. Enjoy the week. Yeah. So I'm curious to know, what is everybody's favorite? Tiago says Indonesia is the new Korea, according to Philip McKnight. Do you want to comment on that, Jeff? Because we were just talking about that before.
We were, and there is some truth to it. Some truth to it. I think Phil might slightly overstate it, but I will tell you that a lot of the companies that have been traditionally in Korea are moving to Indonesia. Is there a quality difference between them? Yeah, of course there is. Is it hugely disproportionate? No. You know, they're very similar in quality, and their finishes in some of the factories have gotten really good too. But pricing is lower. So it's always that relativity of price versus quality in the manufacturing process. Mm-hmm. You know, when you drop in price from its standard price, there's always some sacrifice, because you can't make the identical guitar in someplace else and make it cheaper and have it be exactly the same. That's impossible to do. But what's true about it is a lot of the companies are moving that are leaving Korea, because the fact is there's very limited manufacturing in Korea. There's really only two factories that are making guitars in Korea, and neither of them really have a whole lot of capacity. So in terms of the quality of the craftsmanship, you're seeing a lot more of people moving over and then taking Indonesia as their second choice, rather than, you know, the China game has just gotten out of control bad. And, you know, then you kind of go to Vietnam or you got to go to Mexico. And so Indonesia is the next best choice. If I expanded my line, I would probably go into Indonesia, but those guitars would all be lower priced than what I make now, necessarily.
Isn't it true? There's another Korean factory called, what's the name of the other Korean factory?
Mir.
Mir. Thank you. How do you spell that, by the way?
Oh, I don't know. Okay. M-I-R, I think.
Are they still producing guitars?
Yeah, as far as I know. I mean, that's where I think Reverend was making their guitars.
Yes, I think you're right.
I don't know any other. They're very small manufacturing, so they can't put out the volume that World does. Mm-hmm. So they don't have a whole lot of customers, and they're not necessarily bigger customers. But that's kind of the only game in town in Korea. You know, you can't get cases out of Korea at all.
What do you mean? Actual guitar cases?
Yeah, there's nobody in Korea that makes them.
By the way, the cases you have always made, I'm sorry, I was reading the comments. You made some of the best cases in your gig bags. Your cases are phenomenal. Some of the best cases I've ever seen.
Thank you.
Did those come out of Korea?
No. they come out of China actually, but cases and bags is something that China does well. Guitars, not so much. They do electronics well, they do cases and bags well. Now, that being said, like I do with my guitars, I have very particular specifications on my cases, and it's so they're not the same as what you're going to get from people who are ordering standard cases of, you know, size X or Y. I make some changes to the way they build the cases to radically increase the quality and durability of the case. But that's a product that China still does well. You just can't get them anywhere else. Indonesia makes cases, but they're radically more expensive for some reason, and not the quality is not any better. But those are the only places that I've seen cases and bags come out of.
Gotcha. By the way, we have a question for you from Gravel Stevo 179. Says, any sale on Diamond amps?
So somebody else asked me that today. The answer is yes, but we're running private sales for the customers. So if there's a Diamond amp that you want to buy, you can get it on a sale price right now. You just have to email us and tell us what you want to buy, and we can give you sale prices. They're still built to order, so you still got to wait for it. But you can get it on a sale price, and all you got to do is email sales@diamondguitars.com and just tell them that you heard about the private sale and you want to, if you want to purchase one, you know, we can give you the sale price at that time.
There it is. Thomas McBee, hello. J-Bone says, as a beginner, I'm liking the Bolero LTX Galaxy Purple that's for sale. That's a hot guitar. And, you know, those flip-flop colors are, you know, that's usually something you see on a very high-end, high-priced guitar.
Yeah, I was really actually, the one thing I was really actually mad about that color is that was another rip-off color, because Schecter started coming out with that color and coming out of it out of the same factory. And I really pissed off at the factory, because that flip, you know, there's a lot of flip-flop paints out there, but that particular formula that we use on the Galaxy Purple, that is a formula I mixed myself. And so I was not pleased the fact that they were started showing up, my proprietary formula started showing up on some Schecters. But weird things like single cuts with Floyds in Galaxy finishes. But whatever. I mean, I don't really care, and I never bother to say anything to any of these people, but it did really piss me off.
Oh, you do. Are you still working with David Blankenship? That's long gone, right?
It's Roy. And yeah, we haven't worked with Roy in, gosh, I don't know, since like 2012, maybe.
So of your small amps, you had the Assassin.
Mm-hmm.
Was it Positron?
Correct.
And then there was a third one, wasn't there?
No, those were the only two small ones that we did. And for a long time, we only released them as heads, as little mini heads. But you could also get a 112 closed back cabinet for them.
I could have sworn there was a third.
No, we offered a small head in the Blankenship line.
What was that called?
That was called the Carry-On.
No. I'm telling you, I know I'm arguing with the wrong guy because it's your company, but I swear I could have remembered, like Del Fuego?
Oh, yeah, if you want to count that. But the Del Fuego was basically the same physical size as like the Assassin.
See, I was right. There was a third.
But the Del Fuego was only USA made, and the Positron and the Assassin were imported to keep the cost down.
Wait, so say, I'm sorry, I was reading the comment. Can you repeat that last thing for me?
The Del Fuego was only USA made.
Ah, okay.
It was very classically toned, vintage-y toned. The Assassin and the Positron, I made import to keep the cost down and make it more available. In fact, one day I should tell you the very short story about how we went about making those so that we could preserve the quality of them.
The Positron and the
Assassin.
Okay. So give us the Reader's Digest version.
Well, what happens is, I've seen this with so many manufacturers, what they do is they design something, they make it in the U.S., and then they send it to their factory over in China to make, and they get them in, and they can't understand why they're wrong and what's going on, and they can't figure out what the problem is. Well, the problem is when they do that, the Chinese substitute their own components for what they can get over there for things of the same value. So what we did was we went out and got all of the components from them that we needed, and we designed the amp around the components that are available to them so that when we finished our prototype, it would be exactly replicated. And there was a handful of components that we just could not find suitable replacements for. So I used to have to buy certain components and ship them over there for inclusion in our amps to get it the way we wanted it.
Interesting.
That's how we did it and preserved the quality in the tonal properties.
So the F4, which is right back over there.
That was an imported amp too.
Yep, that was an imported. The F4 and the Assassin, were they absolutely their own thing, or was the tone inspired from one of your US series amps?
No, the basic structure of it was inspired by one of my amps. Like, you know, we used the same kind of board layout and same kind of overall structure and design, same kind of circuit design. But the tonal property was something that didn't exist in the rest of the line. And what I did with that amp was essentially I wanted market share from the PV5150. So, and what I didn't like, I like a lot about the 5150, but the reason that I never could get it to sound good enough when you play with it for me was they built that amp around quarter watt resistors, and they stepped everything down to lower wattage to be able to use it. Still a 100 watt head, but they reduced the voltage internally to try to make it less expensive. And I wanted to do what I thought that amp should have been tonally and quality wise. So it was very much in that percussive gain kind of structure that you'd see with like the 5150.
I would have guessed the F4 would have been more like the Hammersmith.
I mean, in some ways, but you know, the Hammersmith is kind of that modded JCM 800 thing, which was really the basis for the Soldano SLO, which was sort of the basis for the SLO was sort of the basis for the 5150. The Hammersmith was a sort of modded SLO where it didn't take that US kind of modification like you'd see in the SLO. It took more of a British modification. The F4 was a couple of generations removed from that, but in a different voicing style. That's where the similarities came from. If it was most similar to anything, it was probably most similar to the Phantom, but it was still even very different from that.
Yeah. Eric Smith says, why are the 112 so small out of the Assassin? Notice the resale value sucks. You know, I have to be honest with you. The Assassin, respectfully, I disagree, because I've seen them sell used for as much as 700, as low as 400 to 500. And when you think about what else you could buy on the used market for 400 to 500, I mean, you could buy a USA made 5150 for 400 to 500. I just think the problem is it's not the amp. I just think there is so much gear on the used market. It's tough.
Resale for almost everything for musical equipment sucks.
However, and I've noticed this, by the way, if so here's a little tip on how to sell something. If you could hold off or hold out, I should say, for a fair asking price, if you could hold out, like if you need a fire sale and you bring it to Guitar Center, they'll kill you on the price. If you want to just move something, you'll always take a beating on the price. If you could hold out, like if I was to sell, I still own my Diamond Assassin. If I was to sell my Diamond Assassin, I wouldn't sell for less than $500. And that's a what, $700 amp? Here's the reason why. There weren't many made. Jeff, yeah. How many Assassins would you say were made? Because to me, it's a rare amp. I wouldn't take less than $500 on a used market.
In total, I think we made between $200 and $250.
There you go.
And it's very difficult to find, but yep. Consequently, a lot of people don't know what it is. So it's kind of like any specialty product. You're going to get a higher resale value for it when you find the right buyer who knows what it is.
But if you're holding off.
If you just stick it on eBay and somebody doesn't know what it is, they're just not going to pay for it. Of course, on a lot of those nowadays, it doesn't matter what you offer for people. you put it up there for any price you want. People offer you 50% of it.
That's right. So, Derek,
want to sell it and get more money for it? Ask for twice the price that you think it's worth, and then let somebody make you an offer for half the price. Yep.
So Derek, I think the Guitar Center thing you're referring to, some guy probably brought it in. Guitar Center low balls all day long. They probably brought it in for $200. They made $80 on it. That's how I see it. But I don't think that's, I don't know. I think that's rare. I'd probably buy it for that much, right? I mean, that probably costs more than your cost.
Speaking of selling stuff at Guitar Center, you know, somebody that we both know very well, who still remain nameless,
okay,
got busted trying to sell a trailer full of my products that may or may not have come from my warehouse used at Guitar Center.
I think I might know who that is.
You do know who it is. Took a trailer full of that product and took it around to three Guitar Centers trying to sell it all used.
Is he an actual touring artist?
No, he's not a touring artist.
Oh, he's not a touring artist.
No.
Huh. So the touring artist story was someone else trying to sell your thing.
That was an amp.
Yes. Okay, that one I know.
That was one of my amps that I loaned to Zoltan that somebody else took and sold. Yeah.
So I knew, I thought maybe that was, now I'm wondering. We're definitely going to have a chat after the chat. Interesting. So what happened? How did this individual get busted?
Somebody at one of the, at the first Guitar Center knew us and knew him and said, and put the kibosh on it and said, no, we're not going to buy any. And then called the other local Guitar Centers, because there was more than one in his city, and told them all, if this person shows up, don't buy them.
Wow. How did this person get it? Was actually stolen from you? Stolen might be a strong word, right?
Yeah.
Gotcha. Okay. Interesting. Well, we'll save that story for another day. So it's 1:30 a.m. here in New Jersey. It's officially 4th of July. Happy birthday, America. And I hope everybody has a fantastic 4th of July. Don't forget, there are links in the description below. And one of those links is Jeff's links to the sale. And he also has the coupon code, which is, you would only know, Jeff, if they were watching the show. I'm not even going to put it in the description below. So, Jeff, tell me one more time. It's TTKLIVE04. So yeah. If you've made it this far, that'll save you an extra $20 on shipping. So,
hey, is Terry Boyer online?
Who?
Terry.
Yes, he is. Terry GG&G. And Terry, thank you as always for moderating. I really appreciate it, buddy. Thank you.
Here, ask Terry if he'll, well, I guess he can hear me. Terry, would you do us a solid and repost the links and the coupon codes for everybody in the comments? Because I think he's the one that posted them earlier. Maybe he can just clip them and repost them for us in the comments.
Jason Wade, thank you for the thanks, buddy. From me to you.
There it is. My other buddies are online. Send me a shout out so TTK can call them out for me, because I can't see who's in the chat.
Yeah. So why don't you just tell me where you're from and we'll say goodbye on the way out. Here we go. I'm going to try to keep up with 178 viewers all at one time. Thank you, Terry.
And while you guys are doing that, don't forget, most of those guitars are limited. I think the highest SKU count we have of any of those on that sale is 12. Right. So go fast.
I got to go. Madraj, California, Dave R, Oregon, Michael B. Thank you for the timestamps, buddy. And your care package will be on its way. Todd Hansen, Habs from San Antonio, Eddie Small, Kevin from Australia, Derek, Danitas, thank you. Arvon, happy 4th to you as well. Station, NYC, good night to you. Thomas from Louisiana, Derek from Texas, Aljon, buddy from Nashville, Tiago, Grand Prairie, Canada, Dragon Model. Be careful. Don't blow your fingers off tomorrow. I will not. Jim from Florida. Brian from Oregon. Thank you, Brian. We'll see you soon. Jeffrey Monroe. Great Vanzini from Four Corners, Oregon. Mark Dillon from Canada. Ron Barefoot Mode, Kevin Yay. Kevin Hall, he says yay. Terry, as always, Dragon, Kubrick, John, Al, Darren, Tonosaur, Robert, music from Ecuador, Jamie, Sterling, Terry again, thank you. Ian, Habs, Gonzo, and if I missed you, Gravel Stevo, I'm sorry if I missed you. Have a great fourth at John Parson, Dave R, and Al John, yes. And to everyone else, be safe on the 4th of July. Everyone loves fireworks, but they could be dangerous. Safety first. So thanks, everyone. Have a great night. Jeff, thanks for joining. And hope everyone has a great 4th. Go buy a Diamond guitar. Good sales going on. Great guitars. And, you know, that's your TTK killer deal for the July 4th. And all the links are in the description below. Don't remember, TTKLIVEO4 saves you an extra 20 on shipping. See you later. Thank you.